Thank you everyone for joining us in Boston and online by webcast at our first Knowledge in Motion lecture in webcast. We are webcasting this evening's lecture to 26 states nationwide and internationally to countries such as Canada, Argentina, and Wales. It gives me great pleasure to introduce this evening Dr. Susan Bergman as our guest lecturer. Dr. Bergman has been a physiatrist at Boston's Community Medical Group, soon to be known as Commonwealth Community Care, since 1993. She's an attending physician at both Boston Medical Center and Metro West Medical Center and has been in private practice since 2003. Dr. Bergman worked as a staff physiatrist on the SCI unit at the New England Regional Spinal Cord Injury Center at Boston Medical Center from 1985 to 2003 and has served as the clinical director of the SCI Center. She is also a consulting physiatrist to nursing facilities in the area and has consulted to a number of area facilities, including Spalding Rehabilitation Hospital in 1986 and 1987. Dr. Bergman works with the Framingham Accountable Care Organization and the New England Quality Care Alliance to expand the availability of comprehensive, affordable, coordinated care to patients and communities. She received her MD from the Boston University School of Medicine in 1982 and is board certified in spinal cord injury medicine. Dr. Bergman is Associate Clinical Professor at PM&R at Boston University School of Medicine. I'd also like to say that she was one of my attending physicians when I was a resident at Boston Medical Center, and I have tremendous amounts of respect for her.
Thank you.
It gives me great pleasure to introduce her this evening.
Thank you so much, Leslie. That was wonderful. I really appreciate it. It's so great to see so many people here in the room, a lot of familiar faces, and I'm really thrilled. We're going to be talking tonight about staying well after spinal cord injury. It's kind of a delicate balancing act, and we're going to talk about what you folks can do to take charge of your own wellness and how we in the healthcare professions can help you to make that happen. Leslie already went through the experience that I've had, but I also should tell you that spinal cord injury is very near and dear to my own heart. The reason I went into this is that my dad, in 1966, had meningoencephalitis, probably triple E, and he spent about half of his life as a T1 paraplegic. I wanted to give special thanks to two people who really helped a great deal in putting this together. Dr. Sungyul Kim, who was my professor and colleague, and he provided invaluable insights, especially around some of the history that I'd like to review. And to Mary Glover, who's the co-founder of Boston Community Medical Group and the executive director of Commonwealth Care Center. If any of you have read Malcolm Gladwell's Blink, he talks a great deal about how factors that aren't really obvious kind of come together to change events and to really influence how things go. And right now, healthcare is really in a crisis. The Chinese word for crisis combines the characters for danger and opportunity. And we are in a unique situation that has the potential to work out really, really well or to be a huge disaster. There are a number of opportunities now for innovation and significant improvement of healthcare for everybody. And what we need to do is to look to innovators of the past who created spinal cord injury care as we know it, pretty much out of nothing. And I'm going to review some history, which at first would seem not to be related, but I think we really do need to know where we came from in order to get a better idea of where we're going and how to get there. The dangers that we're in healthcare are that runaway costs threaten gains that people worked for many years and fought really hard to get in the independent living movement, the disability rights movement, and even in the model systems itself. Certainly since I started practice in 1985, it's been one change after the other, and it feels like you can never really catch up because something is always changing. The statistics that the model systems have collected since 1973 showed for a little while a very nice decrease in the morbidity and mortality statistics and a very nice increase in lifespan. And it seems that, at least at the beginning, some of those statistics may be going in the wrong direction. And that is partially because of a tendency to try to make cuts wherever we can and to save money and be penny wise and pound foolish. And a good example of that is when I first started practice, if you were a quadriplegic, at the time of discharge, you got an air mattress, period. And now it's very difficult to justify getting this rather expensive piece of equipment. But with an investment up front, it can really save a lot of grief down the line. There are also opportunities. There are a number of different entities that are working really hard to adapt and try to come up with creative solutions to the problems that we find ourselves with. People who are dual eligible, who have Medicare and Medicaid, have some particular issues, because what happens is you've got two huge programs who sometimes duplicate each other's effort and sometimes find that they're not covering things that really need to be covered, and there are a lot of kinks that need to be worked out. The good news is that there are a lot of really well-meaning, good, smart people who are working on this problem, especially here in Massachusetts. So we're very lucky to have some resources here. Also, experiences of the past can offer us some solutions to look at in the future. The biggest challenge in the future, in my opinion and in Dr. Kim's opinion, is going to be how to manage acute medical problems in people who have had spinal cord injuries for a long time. I think that we sort of have it together when it comes to treating people with new injuries and kind of teaching them how to adapt. But what happens to the person who's had a spinal cord injury for 35 years and suddenly develops lung cancer? Or suddenly develop some other, you know, diabetes or some other health issue that might land them in the hospital. A lot of primary care physicians in the community are very familiar with the general population and the problems that they get into, but people with spinal cord injury have some different physiology, some different issues that can interact with the problems of aging and can get very confusing. It can be really difficult sometimes to tease out what's going on with someone who's coming in with a change in their baseline function. And it really does take a village. It takes a team to really kind of help people to figure out what's going on and solve the problem so that they can move on with their lives. And my opinion is that sometimes we spend so much time trying to find the latest and the greatest and prove it scientifically that we forget about some of the old time-honored techniques of the past that provide the art of medicine, because medicine is an art as well as a science. And I think if we can remember that, we will be able to do a lot to help people to live their lives. And investing in the right equipment and educating the people who are dealing with spinal cord injury, you folks, in the long run will pay off hugely. So it's not just a matter of educating doctors and medical students and nurses and therapists, not just the healthcare providers, but the healthcare consumers as well. that the thing that helps the most is if you folks know your own bodies and can help us to help you to solve the problems that are coming down the pike. History of spinal cord injury care is probably in order here. From the earliest Egyptians, it was considered an ailment not to be treated because they didn't have the ability to prolong life. People would die usually within days at the very beginning. Over time, the healthcare system got better. Particularly, the real turning point was the development of antibiotics towards the end of World War II. All of a sudden, infections could be treated, and people were living more than a couple of weeks or months. And all of a sudden, there was this large population of people who were surviving with spinal cord injury, and nobody was really sure exactly what to do and how to keep them well. There were some parallel developments in the civilian and in the veteran populations, much like we're seeing today with traumatic brain injury. We have a lot of people coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan with traumatic brain injury, and all of a sudden there's this huge population, and the folks in the Veterans Administration system and the folks in the civilian healthcare system are really scrambling trying to figure out what to do to make their lives high quality and keep them well. Most of what we know now about how to take care of someone with spinal cord injury comes from the work of two people that were pretty much working at the same time in two different places. The first was Sir Ludwig Gutmann, who was working in England, and the second was Dr. Donald Munro, who was working here in Boston at Boston City Hospital. Sir Ludwig Gutmann was a German-Jewish neurosurgeon who escaped Nazi Germany in 1935 and went to England. And the British government recruited him to build a program to treat veterans and civilians who were coming back after World War II. And he developed management strategies for the most life-threatening sequelae or consequences of spinal cord injury. And some of the things that he figured out included turning people frequently so that they wouldn't develop decubitus ulcers, chest physical therapy and assisted cough to help mobilize pulmonary secretions so they didn't get pneumonia, timed intermittent catheterization to decompress the bladder and keep the bacterial population in the urine down, the use of acidifying agents to make the urine kind of a hostile environment for invasive bacteria, and a timed bowel regime so that people could stay continent. The other thing that Sir Ludwig believed was that it was very important to stay active in order to prevent the negative side effects of spinal cord injury. And in the 1940s, he and a group of 26 patients at the Stoke Mandeville Hospital developed the game of netball, and they also experimented with different sports like table tennis and archery, javelin, shot put, lawn bowling. And these innovations formed the basis of what we now know as the Paralympics, wheelchair sports. There's a really great book, it's in your handout, it's called Wheelchair Champions, A History of Wheelchair Sports, and it's written by Harriet May Savitz. It's really cool, I recommend that you read it. Around the same time, a neurosurgeon here in the U.S. named Donald Munro was working on developing spinal cord injury care for the whole person. And he's been called the father of paraplegia. He established the first spinal cord injury unit in the United States at the Boston City Hospital in 1936. Probably his biggest contribution was an attitude of optimism and compassion and looking at people with spinal cord injury as the people and individuals that they truly are. He was trained as a neurosurgeon, but his thing was rehabilitation, and he realized that you couldn't just concentrate on one thing. You had to look at all of the aspects of not just medical care, but rehabilitation and community reentry. And he was really the first person to see it that way in the US. Some other important pioneers that are locally famous, Dr. Alan Rossier, who was at the West Roxbury VA. He was a paraplegic himself, and he pioneered care for treating subsequent medical issues in people with chronic injury. And he advocated for care of spinal cord injury regardless of what stage they were at. Fred Fay is the former director of the Assistive Technology Center at Tufts New England Medical Center, and he advocated for measures like funding PCA care to allow individuals with disabilities to re-enter the community and play an active role. And he was very active politically. He was quadriplegic himself, and he couldn't get out of bed. He was lying flat because whenever he sat up, he got dizzy. So he did a lot of this work pretty much from the bed. He worked very closely with members of the Massachusetts congressional delegation, including Senator Edward Kennedy. There was an interesting PBS documentary recently about him. The other people and institutions that I want to mention include Elmer Bartels, who was also quadriplegic, and he was the Massachusetts Rehabilitation Commissioner for many, many years. And he helped to establish Boston Center for Independent Living, which was originally established as a group residential program for people who were just coming out of the hospital but weren't really ready to go back to their homes. And this place was in an apartment complex near the School of Theology at Boston University. And they had transitional living centers, which were focused on developing independent living skills and living in the community, training personal care attendants. To be an employer is something that most people are not really used to. And to develop that relationship, which is really a professional relationship, kind of allows people to take charge of their own care and to pretty much have the care the way they want it. They've now completely phased out of independent living and group living, and they provide primarily skills training and assistance with PCA hiring and management. Dr. Murray Fried definitely deserves special mention. One of Dr. Monroe's students was Dr. Murray Fried, who lost a leg in the Battle of the Bulge in World War II. He was a tank commander. And he came back and started practice in 1956 at Boston University and created the New England Regional Spinal Cord Injury Center at Boston Medical Center in 1973. He was part of the group that worked with the federal government to establish the model systems in the first place in the 1970s. And what had happened then, Vietnam era veterans were coming back with spinal cord injury, and that greatly increased the population. And yet again, all of a sudden they have all these people coming back and they're really not quite sure what to do. So they realized that they had to start keeping real statistics and getting real science to develop the best practices for keeping people well. And the United States government gave grants to 13 hospitals across the country in different regions to establish integrated regionalized systems to offer multidisciplinary care to people with spinal cord injury from the time that they were hurt until the day that they were no longer with us. These institutions allowed for the development of treatment protocols, databases, statistically proven best practices, and experienced teams to deal with a very high intensity, but truly a low incidence diagnosis. I think now in the US, there are maybe somewhere between 250 and 300,000 people with spinal cord injury. And if you're talking about a country the size of ours, that's not a large number. But as you all know, it's a pretty intense diagnosis, and it really does take a lot of balance to live well with a spinal cord injury. At the time, the regional model was very important in order to eliminate duplication of effort and to divide labor so that it was most efficient. And what the model systems did and still do is to stress educating the patient in order to learn about their altered physiology, because it is altered. And they used the power of peer support and family support. They worked and coordinated with local resources, particularly in the Massachusetts Rehabilitation Commission. And Dr. Fried worked very closely with Liberty Mutual Insurance Company and with BCIL. And the model systems worked really well. They've since expanded it to cover other conditions, including traumatic brain injury. And what we've learned over time has allowed us in the healthcare system to offer better care to people with all kinds of conditions, including childhood onset conditions like cerebral palsy, and acquired conditions like multiple sclerosis and strokes and all kinds of conditions. The New England Regional Spinal Cord Injury Center was based at Boston Medical Center from 1973 through July of this year, when it was closed by the hospital. And it was a regional resource for patients with spinal cord injuries at all levels. The unit I worked on was the fifth floor of the Preston Building. It was affectionately known as F5. And it was a very special place. It was something between a hospital, a school, and a boot camp. And we cared for people. Anybody who was ready to leave the surgical intensive care unit got admitted directly to F5. Anybody with a chronic spinal cord injury who had another medical problem also was assigned a bed there. And if it was, say, a kidney issue, the renal specialists would come on as consultants. They would come onto our service. And that way, they were able to utilize the resources of the team. The ward was physically designed to eliminate architectural as well as personal barriers. And the nursing protocols were built around bowel and bladder management. Equipment was specially designed to prevent skin breakdown and improve ease of use for patients. So they had call lights that could be turned on by turning your head, or voice activated, and tongue touch keypad, and so on. You didn't find that on the average medical surgical unit. By design, folks with new injuries were placed in the same room with people who had been injured for many years, and patients and families learned to problem solve together. And that was very, very powerful. Over the 1980s and 1990s, life expectancy increased. People with spinal cord injury went back home and re-entered the community. They went back to jobs, they went back to families, and by the time of discharge, these folks who were rehabbed this way were experts in their own care, and they could talk anybody through it with or without a medical background. We would discharge people on ventilators home, and they would have PCAs with no medical background, and they would explain, okay, these are the vent settings, this is how you do the suctioning, put the tube right here, turn on this switch. They could direct their care. And that's huge. At that time, insurers found this very valuable. And at one time, anybody in the United States with a spinal cord injury from work who was covered by Liberty Mutual Insurance Company came to Boston to be cared for by Dr. Fried and his team. And after discharge, they went back home to North Carolina or Georgia or wherever, and went back to their own internists and their own communities. And if they had a problem, the team was available by telephone to their care team. They would come back regularly, every once in a while, for sort of a tune-up, I guess. Essentially, it was a medical surgical unit with a rehabilitation focus. It was an unusual place. And unfortunately, with rising healthcare costs, the way care was delivered had to change, and it changed very quickly. because it was zoned as a medical surgical unit, the cost of having people come to this unit was much higher than to a rehabilitation unit or a freestanding rehabilitation facility. It had an advantage that you could care for people seamlessly. If somebody had a DVT, they didn't, you know, they could still be cared for on the rehab unit. They didn't have to get transferred to the acute hospital and then come back. But that kind of care was very expensive. And after a while, with managed care and DRGs being implemented to reduce the costs of care, there was a big push to deliver care in a less expensive setting. They were shortening lengths of stay. The rehabilitation units were becoming restricted to people with new injuries only. And if a medical problem came up, the person would be discharged from rehab back to the acute hospital and then readmitted when they were stable and able to participate in the rehab program. Sometimes, though, they would develop new problems in the acute hospital. So this is definitely a work in progress. Care over time has shifted away from the hospital inpatient unit setting towards rehabilitation specialty hospitals and even some skilled nursing facilities. The medical center could no longer afford to maintain a geographically distinct SCI unit. In 1999, the designation changed to a rehabilitation unit, and spinal cord injuries with other medical problems were no longer admitted to the spinal cord unit. They were admitted to the general medical and surgical units. And of course, in July, they closed the last rehabilitation unit within an acute hospital in the state of Massachusetts. So now we are in a period of very rapid change. And again, we're in a period where danger and opportunity come together. And necessity is the mother of invention. Our predecessors responded to the issues of their day by creating systems to deliver the highest possible quality of care to people with complicated conditions. And these systems emphasized wellness and taught people how to manage their medical issues in order to take their rightful places in their communities. And now it's our turn to innovate. It's kind of scary, but it's kind of exciting too. There's a lot of opportunity. It's up to all of us to make sure that the next chapter in medical care of people with disabling conditions represents forward progress. And in Massachusetts, they just passed a law implementing a global payment system instead of fee-for-service. The way things are now, if anytime you have a procedure, it's billed separately. Now they're talking about a lump sum paid to the caregivers at the beginning. As long as the global payments are high enough to cover costs, they would allow people, they'd allow the providers enough flexibility to make investments in the right kind of equipment and the right kind of medication and enough catheters and that kind of thing. You wouldn't have to be micromanaged and told how many catheters your patient needs by, you know, somebody who is over on the other side of the country. Hopefully it's going to work out. There are a lot of working groups now in the state that are exploring the best ways to take care of people with chronic disabling conditions. There are models being developed, models being expanded to coordinate care statewide as well as nationwide. And the Office of Healthcare Innovation and CMS, Medicare, are looking at different models of care in the country. It turns out that there are only three practices in the whole country that concentrate on the needs of people with disabilities. One of them is in New York, one of them is in Wisconsin, and one of them is right here in Boston, and that practice is known as BCMG, Boston's Community Medical Group. It used to be a program within the Urban Medical Group, which was co-founded by Marie Felton, Dr. Marie Felton, Dr. Robert Master, and Mary Glover, nurse practitioner. They worked very closely with BCIL. When people were discharged from the transitional care units, they would be assigned to the Urban Medical Group and Boston Community Med, and they would get their follow-up medical care from them. BCMG delivers community-based primary care to people with complex disabilities. And it's a multidisciplinary team approach, including physicians, nurse practitioners, physician's assistants, behavioral health professionals, PT, OT, speech, social workers, and other disciplines as needed. When someone enrolls, they're assigned to a primary care doctor and either a nurse practitioner or a physician's assistant. And the backbone of this model is home care visits from nurse practitioners and physician's assistants as the first line of care. If the conditions are more complicated, then the MDs would make either home visits or see people in the office depending on the condition. And specialists are consulted on an as-needed basis. There's a team that meets regularly to review patient care plans and go over anybody who's having special problems, kind of brainstorm and pick each other's brains to solve problems, and the model works really well. It's being expanded, and hopefully it will be adopted and used nationwide. There's a lot of challenge in growing the model so that it doesn't get too big to manage, and finding ways to regionalize it, but that's being worked on, and let's talk in a few years and we'll see where we wind up. Because the problem is that the backbone of this model of care is going out to the home. And that's great. It really is great for the patient. It's great for us because we get to see the environment. You can learn an awful lot about somebody by going into the home. The problem is that it's a very time-consuming way to do it. And you can only travel so far. If you're going to be driving for 2 hours, and then spending an hour with somebody in their home and driving back for 2 hours, that's more than half of the day, and you really can't see very many people in that amount of time. So stay tuned, and we'll see how this works out, but it's being addressed, it's being examined, and it's pretty exciting. BCG is expanding. It's now part of Community Medical Alliance, and the name is going to change from BCMG to Commonwealth Community Care. And the name may change, but the commitment to care won't be changing. It's the prototype of what's called the patient-centered medical home, which is probably a phrase that you are hearing a lot about. The model's being explored by a number of different entities, and it really blows me away that in the last year, I've just been kind of out of the blue asked to sit on two advisory boards that are not related to CCA to develop patient-centered medical homes in different parts of the state. So this is all wonderful, but what does that mean to you? What do you do? Where do you go to get medical care when you have a spinal cord injury? The new system offers good points and bad points. The emphasis on the patient-centered medical home really validates and reinforces the rehab model that has been in use here and has been in use at Boston Medical Center for a number of years. The team approach really is very powerful, with the patient really at the center of the team, trying to set goals, try to see what is it that you want to do with your life? What are you trying to do? How do we have to do it differently? Each member of the team has something, a different area of expertise to offer and bring to the table. And as I said before, the community-based care allows, if you're feeling rotten, the last thing you want to do is drag yourself into a van and drive for an hour to go to a doctor's office and then wait an hour to see somebody. It's a lot better if someone can come out to the house and try to problem solve. You know, you might end up having to go to the office at some point, but it kind of helps to reduce the number of times that you have to do that. And the team members can pick each other's brains to deal with problems. There might be something that I've seen a million times that's very routine for me. My colleague may not, and the other way around. I mean, when it comes to managing diabetes and hypertension, I'm not the best person to go to. But that's why there's a team. A large influx of new people all at once means that you might be seeing someone without a lot of experience with spinal cord injury. And in one sense, it's not a new issue. That's what used to happen in the regionalized model. People went back to their communities and went back to their own internists and local doctors. So in one sense, that's not something new. We know how to deal with it, hopefully, and it's a matter of keeping the lines of communication open. So it all comes down to arming yourself with as much accurate information as you possibly can. Go to lectures like this one, get on the internet, read the books from the Paralyzed Veterans Association, the National Spinal Cord Injury Association, and educate, educate, educate. In brief, your best bet is to know your own body and be able to articulate your needs and concerns, and to use every available possible resource to educate yourself. You are the one who knows your body best. And in the new world of healthcare, you might also be the person who knows the most about spinal cord injury in the room. The good news is that healthcare providers really want to help. We're trained to recognize disease patterns, and we can work together. Some of the new communication platforms, like electronic medical records, increases your access to information that used to be locked away. And if you're far from spinal cord injury resources, you can encourage your healthcare provider to call a regional center for help. When you go into a medical visit, you want to be as organized as you possibly can to make the most of your time. Poor primary care providers are really being squeezed from every possible direction. They have 20 minutes, if they're lucky, to try to work with a patient and address all of their concerns. So it might be a good idea to consider writing down your questions or bringing somebody with you who can help to make sure that all of your concerns are addressed at the visit so you don't run out of time. It's important to address certain issues at every visit because sometimes symptoms that don't seem to be related really are. And one symptom that you may not think is important might provide the whole key to unlocking the puzzle of what's going on. Dr. Fried used to use the mnemonic NIBBLES, which is very helpful. It's easy to remember. NIBBLES stands for neurologic and orthopedic status, integument or skin, bladder and the urinary tract, bowels and digestive issues, lungs and other general medical issues, equipment issues, and sexuality and psychological concerns. For the neurologic and orthopedic status, the questions that hopefully are being addressed is, have there been any changes in your motor or sensory level since your last visit? Are you in any pain? And if so, where is it located? What does it feel like? What makes it better? What makes it worse? Are there any joint deformities, any fractures, any changes in your range of motion, osteoporosis, scoliosis, or kyphosis? I forgot to put on the slide, upper extremity overuse. It's huge if you've been pushing a wheelchair for 15 years. We're meant to walk on our legs, not our arms. And pretty much everybody with a spinal cord injury eventually develops some kind of upper extremity overuse syndrome. Spasticity is huge. If there's been a change in your level of spasticity, it has to be investigated. It's a good idea to try to get a handle of what time period the change has taken place in, what parts of your body are being affected, and does it interfere with your function? Does it interfere with your sleeping? Is it painful? In some cases, it's important to remember that spasticity may actually help, that it might help you to bear weight. It might help in transfers, might help maintain muscle bulk and circulation. So you don't treat it just because it's there, you treat it if it's causing trouble. The other thing is that changes in the baseline pattern and level of your spasticity will increase if there's any kind of a stimulus that would hurt. So it might be the first sign of a problem. If all of a sudden you have had a certain level of spasticity and suddenly it goes up, we have to really look for the source. Is there a urinary tract infection? Is there a kidney stone? Is there an occult fracture that maybe we missed because you didn't feel it? Is there an ulcer? Is there esophageal reflux? Most of the time, the source will either be in the digestive tract or in the urinary tract. And it can be the first symptom of a bigger problem. So it's important to be alert to changes. Probably the worst issues are skin issues. The worst thing that can happen to someone with a cord injury is to develop a decubitus ulcer. It doesn't take very much. It takes very little sustained pressure. One thing you can do if you're wearing glasses and you can do it is to sort of slowly lower your glasses over your knuckle and wait to see how much pressure it takes to make it change color. It isn't much. And if you are sitting and you cut off the circulation to small capillaries to the skin, you end up with actually the death of skin tissue. And skin ulcers are like icebergs. What you see on the surface is just the tip. What's underneath is a lot more important and maybe much bigger than what you see just on the surface. So they're much better prevented than trying to deal with them. And the key to prevention is pressure relief. Frequent turns, physically shifting, the proper cushions, the proper mattresses, the right design of the wheelchairs, taking pressure off bony prominences will help to prevent deep tissue loss. And really, an ounce of prevention is worth a ton of cure here. So do your pressure reliefs, make sure your equipment is maintained properly, watch for your transfers, watch your technique, especially during toilet transfers and car transfers so you don't end up with a little scrape. At the first sign of a breakdown, get off of it and call your healthcare provider and let them know. Don't try to tough it out and pretend it isn't there because it's going to cause a lot of trouble down the line. Bladder. Neurogenic bladder is present in almost everybody with spinal cord injury in one form or another, and it has to be addressed. And before Sir Ludwig started intermittent catheterization, people would get repeated urinary tract infections, they'd get scarring of the delicate kidney tissue, and life expectancy was shortened to an average of about 18 months. So what we want to do is to prevent that from happening. The goals of bladder management include preventing urine from flowing back up into the kidneys at high pressure, keeping the pressure inside the bladder from getting too high, limiting the number and type of bacteria that sit in the urine, keeping it empty on a time basis so that the population of bacteria doesn't get too large, and to prevent infection, preventing incontinence so that the skin stays dry and odor is prevented, limiting the amount of time that foreign bodies are present in the bladder because in the long run they can produce, they can increase the risk of infection and even the risk of tumors. Prevent the formation of stones, prevent infection, and early detection and treatment of poor kidney function or tumors. The earlier you catch it, the more chance there is to cure it. Medications to reduce high bladder pressure and promote urine flow are available, making sure your fluid intake is adequate, intermittent catheterization, suprapubic tube and Foley catheter, last resort. If you have them in, make sure that you're getting cystoscopy. It's just as important as mammograms for women in the general population. Botox has some limited applications. It's not a cure-all, but it does help in certain situations. And urinary acidifiers to make the urine a hostile environment for the most invasive bacteria can be really helpful. Baseline urodynamics to determine your pressure levels doesn't have to be done every year, but it's a good idea to get it done at a baseline. And then if you're having any problems, it might be ordered. Renal ultrasound every couple of years. Urinalysis and culture if you're having a UTI symptom. And what you're really looking for is if there are white blood cells in your urine, if there's pus in your urine, because everybody's cultures are positive. Don't chase a positive culture. It's a waste of time. And you want to be alert to symptoms of spasticity or autonomic dysreflexia. Blood work needs to be checked pretty much just like anybody else. Neurogenic bowel. It's present in most, if not all, of people with spinal cord injury one way or another. And maintaining continence is a goal that can be reached, but it's a very delicate balance that requires A very carefully balanced diet, carefully balanced fluids. It's not easy to do, but it's well worth the effort. Let your provider know if you're having trouble, if you're having dysreflexia, if you're having increased spasticity, if you notice rectal bleeding, if your stools look dark or tarry. That's something that needs to be investigated. If you're over 50, especially if you have a positive family history of colon cancer or polyps, you need to be screened with colonoscopy just like anybody else in the general population. It's more difficult, but it's got to be done. And it's well worth doing just like anybody else. Lungs, general medical, breathing, circulatory issues, screening for lipid disorders and diabetes, because the risks for these are high in the general population and they're even higher if you have a spinal cord injury. If your level is above T6, tell your provider about any episodes of dysreflexia that you might be having. And you want to follow general principles, just like everybody else, for GYN screenings, screenings for sexually transmitted diseases, lipid disorders, diabetes, colorectal cancer, breast, cervical cancer. The same things, it's not like you still have to do all the same things plus, unfortunately. Immunizations, nutrition, and weight management is really important. Obesity is a big problem for all of us, but especially if you can't exercise, it's much harder to manage. So you want to try to be as active as you possibly can and learn to love exercise. There's a wonderful resource at the YMCA in Quincy. They have a great program with adapted machines. They have a physical therapist who come around. And it's well worth it, going to the gym just like anybody. Blood pressure checks are important. Equipment, mobility equipment, wheelchairs, handheld assistive devices, braces, shoes, adapted vehicles. You want to make sure those are in good working order, that they fit properly, and if they don't, tell your provider so that they can be modified or replaced. Adaptive equipment like electric beds, pressure relief mattresses, shower commode chairs, cushions, reachers, splints, utensils, ECUs, and I'm sure I'm forgetting a whole bunch of things. But again, you want to make sure it's in working order. If it's not meeting your needs, let us know. We can try to do battle with the insurers and try to make sure that people get what they need. Most of them, if you can explain to the insurers why somebody needs it, you have a pretty good chance of getting it. Vocational equipment, computers, voice-activated software, speech synthesizers, magnifiers, TDDs. We're blessed to live in a time and a place where technology is available to allow us to interact with large numbers of people relatively easily. Neurogenic sexual dysfunction is an issue for everybody. Fertility and sexually transmitted diseases. Just because you have a spinal cord injury doesn't mean you're infertile. You can get pregnant just like you could before your injury. So you want to make sure that the pregnancy is not unplanned, and you don't want to be surprised. Depression, adjustment, substance abuse screening. It's huge for the general population. It's huge for people with spinal cord injury. So. We should be asking you about it, and if we don't ask you, please tell us. Family stress, because this is not just the person who's going through the spinal cord injury on their own, but for people in their families, for people in their communities. Community reentry is a big process, and there are wonderful behavioral health and social services folks who can help. So the bottom line is that staying well after spinal cord injury is possible, takes a lot of work, takes a lot of commitment, and it takes a team. The current changes in the healthcare system present challenges and opportunities for us to work together and make wellness a goal that can be achieved. There are some resources that are in your handouts on the slides. I really recommend the Paralyzed Veterans Association of America website. They have a wonderful series of monographs that are available as PDF files or can be ordered in print. And they review specific topics like bowel and bladder, dysreflexia, It's written in plain English for consumers, and there's also a set that it's written for providers. The American Spinal Injury Association for people with and without medical backgrounds, the Christopher and Dana Reeve Foundation, funding innovative research and improving quality of life, the Travis Roy Foundation, and the NSCIA that I know you're all familiar with, lifestyle information, peer support, the Yes You Can manual, talking to other people who are in the same position. And remember, you might be in the position to help somebody else, and paying it forward, and that's huge. By sharing your experiences, you can make somebody else's life a little bit easier. That's my contact information, and I guess if anybody has any questions, I know it's a lot of material. Yeah.
Three different questions.
Okay.
The first is, in these new models of taking care of people with spinal cord injury, is there any attention being paid to trying to undo the damage? I know there's various research which is being done all over the world involving stem cells and the like, and it hasn't worked yet, but presumably once it works, it would be very good to plug people into that. Is that already part of the model?
I think we're waiting to hear what happens when these treatments are available. Unfortunately, there have been treatments in the past that looked great but caused more trouble than they caused more problems than they solved. So I think that as new treatments come available and the science proves it, and it proves that these things are not going to harm anybody, I think that they're not specifically considering those things. But as treatments come, just like the whole healthcare system, if there is a treatment and it works and it's safe, I think that the people who, there will be a way for people to get it. They'll find a way. We'll find a way.
Okay. Another thing that people who are on the internet hear about are these various exoskeletons that can get someone into a position where they're not only able to stand up, which mm-hmm. a standing chair would allow, but they're even able to take steps and things of that kind.
Yep.
Again, is that part of the, is that, at the moment, as far as I know, the cost is prohibitive, but if right. the numbers get high enough, it may come down enough to make that possible.
I hope so, because I really feel that that's the key. That, in fact, we were talking about that a little while ago with osteoporosis prevention. Just like in the general population, people who are active do better than people who aren't. If we can prove that we can prevent problems down the line by providing standing frames and exoskeletons and FES bikes, I think that that would be fabulous, and right now the costs are prohibitive, but I would just, sometimes the squeaky wheel gets the grease, and talk to your insurer, talk to your healthcare provider, see if you are a candidate for it, if there's a demonstrator model that you could try, and see. I mean, it's really exciting, and I think it's got a lot of potential and really needs more more work.
Okay, and finally, there is online and in person very passionate debate among people who live with paraplegia about the balance between having a powered wheelchair and having a manual chair, and I'm kind of glad that you actually admitted that absolutely everybody who's trying to propel themselves with their arms will eventually get some kind of upper extremity overuse from it. At what point do we say that giving people powered wheelchairs will prevent them from losing the use of their arms and will save money later?
Really good question, really difficult answer, because sometimes the thing that will solve one problem makes another problem worse. remember that the more calories you burn, the less likely you are to develop diabetes, the less likely you are to develop cardiovascular disease. If you take someone who is a paraplegic and right off the bat you give them a power chair, they may not have the opportunity to stay active. They'd have to be very motivated to do it. So it's really an individualized basis. Some people, you know, if you are living in a remote area and you have to cover a lot of mileage during the day, you're going to, I don't know, University of Maryland, which is the biggest campus I know of, and you've got to cross that campus to go to your classroom, a power chair might make sense, even if you're a para. But if you are really not doing a lot of moving and you're not the type to go to the gym, you might do better if you're in a manual chair. And I think that that's an individualized decision. Certainly, people who are having a lot of shoulder pain, who are having a lot of difficulty, would be candidates for power chairs. In my experience, a lot of the folks that I work with who've been in manual chairs for years and all of a sudden they're having so much trouble with their arms that they have to look at power assist or power chairs, they don't want to make the change because they fought so hard to get to the point where they could manage with a manual wheelchair. So it's not black and white.
But isn't it really a little bit like the skin ulcers in the sense that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure? I'm not saying that they shouldn't exercise, and clearly most people are going to use a manual shower chair and they're going to do the transfers with their arms.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, presumably swimming and whatnot would be good, but overuse, it seems sort of counterproductive to wait for overuse before you switch them.
I know. I mean, and it in certain situations it does make sense, and I think it's a very individualized decision. I mean, I don't know. I do have folks in my practice who are paras who've been using a power chair from the beginning. I have folks in my practice who are quads who are using manual wheelchairs and very proud of it. So it's a very individualized decision. And I would, I don't know. I mean, I think just like everybody in this room is a different size, a different shape, we can't all wear the same clothes, we can't all have the same equipment.
Hi, Boston Community Medical Group. Who is eligible to join that now, and how do you do it?
Oh boy, Mary. You want to help me? Mary Glover is the executive director, and I'm going to defer this question to her. No, I'm glad because she knows more about it than I do. Team approach.
Okay. So we're a practice for adults, people with disabilities. We have a pretty broad geographic area. And right now we are Boston-based at Boston Medical Center, but we go up to Lynn, out to Natick, and south to Brockton. So if you're in that area, you could call our office. I can leave some brochures up here, and we would talk to you about what your needs are and whether it makes sense for you to join our practice. We are planning next year to be expanding and developing regional centers in Western Mass, Central Mass, Lawrence area, and Metro West. So if you don't live in the Boston area, maybe next year would work out.
Thanks.
Hello. We have some questions and comments on the website, on the webcast. And first of all, one person had mentioned in terms of the upper extremity issues,
mm-hmm.
That they work out with VitaGlide, and they use the eMotion power-assisted mm-hmm. manual-type wheelchair.
Mm-hmm.
So you might want to mention that. And a number of people actually have mentioned that. And one other question, Dr. Bergman, is how do you manage to keep your patients engaged and enthusiastic about staying educated as changes occur in our medical services?
Oh, boy. That's a great question. Let's see. The power-assisted wheelchair may well be the answer to your question about starting with power mobility, because it's very flexible. You can turn it on or turn it off, so you can kind of go either, it's a little like a hybrid car, you can go in electric mode or you can go in manual mode. The downside is it's heavier, it's more expensive, it's not as easy to get in and out of a car. You know, so there are trade-offs, but that might very well be, if I had to pick one system, that's probably the system I would pick. How do I keep my patients enthusiastic and engaged? Well, it's more they stay enthusiastic and engaged. I mean, I think the bottom line is that when you have an injury, your life becomes something totally different. And most people don't choose to be in this club. But you sort of have two choices. You can either not face it and have one horrible medical problem after another and really be sick, or you can face it and say, okay, what am I gonna do? How am I going to live the rest of my life? What do I want to do? How do I want to do it? And what is it going to take for me to get there? And it isn't about your level of injury. It's about your outlook. It's about your family support or your peer support. It's about the community. Your healthcare provider can really help. You know, I think I mentioned before, I have experience as the family member of someone with an injury. I think most of us in this profession have some personal exposure, and I'm not shy about admitting that to people. And there are people who are sitting in this room who have used their injury as kind of taken it and said, okay, now what am I gonna do? And they have gone to work, and they've started their own companies, and they've had children, and they've, you know, lived life like anybody. They've done, you know, what they wanted to do, maybe a little differently, but they've done it. And I think that I just sort of try to explain that to people who have new injuries and people who have long-term injuries. Your best bet for having one of those treatments that is in the pipeline actually work for you is if you can keep your general health as good as you possibly can. Because when the cure comes down, it's not going to be for somebody who's got a stage 3 decubitus ulcer and chronic osteomyelitis and renal failure. It's going to be for someone who is in good general health and well-motivated and able to, because I'm able to cooperate with any restrictions or medication regimens or exercise regimens that it's going to take. Yeah.
I had two questions. The first one is that how will Obamacare affect old senior citizens like me with spinal cord injury? And the second thing is, do you have any contacts with the colleges, like MIT? So, like, if I have an invention and they could help me build it, because, like, I want a motorcycle for people where they could stay in their wheelchair and turn it into a motorcycle. Okay?
Okay.
My son has what's called a Firefly. It's made by Rio Mobility out in California, and it's a wonderful contraption. It is a motorcycle that just clips on to the front of his chair, and so when he has to go any distance, he uses it to go to school, he uses it to go to work, and then when he gets there, he just unhooks it, and then he wheels. He's got his own chair. It costs about $2,000. It can go up to 10 miles an hour, and it's really cool. It's fun, too.
Well, I was hoping for 95 miles an hour.
Well, not quite, but it's called Firefly by Rio Mobility.
Okay. I don't know. I think that's being worked out. And that's part of what all of these advisory boards are trying to do. I think that it has the potential, as the data we have from Boston Community Medical Group, which has used global payments since, I don't know, the 1990s maybe, I don't know about the exact timing, is that not only does the quality of care go up, but the cost of care goes down. It's going to be about whether the payment actually covers the costs. And hopefully it will. I mean, I'm hopeful, I'm optimistic, because I think that if we do it right, it can be great. If we do it wrong, it'll be a disaster. And I would just encourage all of you to be in touch with your state representatives and your congresspeople to make sure that it is done right.
How does this affect your using patients outside of that group? Is it like an HMO where you have to get all your care from members of the group?
Mary, do you want to take that one too?
Can I repeat that for the mic so people can hear?
Sure.
How is it? Is it like an HMO where you have to use all of your medical care comes from that group, or are you able to use your health insurance to purchase services from outside of the group?
I'm going to defer that to Mary, but I'm also going to answer your question. There are a number of different models. And I think it could go either way.
Some of that's up to you, Sue. I mean, we are a primary care practice. We're a private practice. So it is possible for Sue to see a patient privately that's outside of the team model. We find the team model's very successful, so we really try to encourage using the team. Right now, we are able to bill fee-for-service for private insurance, but ultimately, the only way a program like ours can be successful is really through these special programs that do pay a global payment or a capitation rate. Because of the nature, the labor-intensive nature of our program, the traveling, the time that we spend with people, the team that we pull together to support people, you can't really survive financially in a standard fee-for-service reimbursement structure, which is why we've worked all these years to really try to develop these special programs. So we have one program now for people with MassHealth, and then next year we're going to be working with the state on the Integrated Care Organization through CCA, Commonwealth Care Alliance, which will be for people of both Medicare and MassHealth. And that's really the way we will be able to, you know, keep these programs going. So
remember too, though, that in the model, even in the regionalized model, there is a way that you could continue to work with your present primary care physician, but if you've got a problem that's related to your spinal cord injury, you could see either me as a consultant, or there are a lot of physiatrists here in Boston. There's a lot of resources.
Well, I'm right now looking for a physiatrist and would also not
mind-changing primary care physician who's familiar with spinal cord injury. I'm sorry.
Well, we can certainly talk after the offline, I think.
Okay.
And,
but I am, you know, I was wondering, what about things like physical therapy and activities like that? Does that have to be within the group or counseling?
It depends on whether you're going to be, if you're going to join the practice as a primary care patient, or we can, I think we can probably answer that kind of specific question afterwards, if that's okay.
One quick clarification. In Massachusetts, MassHealth is Medicaid, for anyone that is unaware.
Sorry.
Hi, I'm a quadriplegic from way back. I've been doing this for a lot of years, and I just wanted to just briefly mention the another good system that tells me when something's wrong, and that's the autonomic dysreflexia.
Mm-hmm.
It is a 100% guarantee if I'm becoming having that experience with the high blood pressure and the chills and the spasticity and so forth, that there's something wrong in my body.
Absolutely.
And I better keep looking until I find it.
Absolutely.
Because without sensation, you know, you don't always know. But I remember I broke my leg once, and I didn't know it was broken until the autonomic dysreflexia was, I couldn't stand it any longer.
Mm-hmm.
And I went in and they finally found that. Especially for quads, I guess. It's a really good alarm system to be very aware of.
Thank you for pointing that out. And it's true, if you have symptoms of dysreflexia, even if they seem to be mild, a little sweaty, a little flushed, maybe not the full-blown, full Monty, it's a good idea to look for a cause. And you're absolutely right. There's always a reason.
I want to shift things a little bit. I'm married to that guy.
And okay.
I've been married to him for a long time. And we travel in the community. We have great medical support. But one of the unique experiences comes when Rob has to use the local emergency room for some issue or another.
Mm-hmm.
And it brings to my mind, having been a participant in medical education over many years, that we still are not doing a very good job of educating young doctors about spinal cord injury and some of the unique aspects. Now, I know they've got a lot to learn, but I just wondered, you know, for example, it's very difficult. They keep saying to them, yes, but how do you feel? Do you have any pain in your stomach? I can't tell you. I mean, I've got my PAT lectures now.
Mm-hmm.
that go on. And it's not, they're not trying to be insensitive.
Right.
They just don't understand. Do you have any ideas about anything that's happening now in medical education that might help that?
Sometimes I don't know which battle to fight and when. You are absolutely right. And I think we just need to reach out to younger doctors. Dr. Freed used to do a lecture for the first year students, and I think that got lost, so we probably need to be more active and making younger doctors aware. You're absolutely right. Ever feel like you're on the Titanic and bailing it out with a teaspoon? Yeah.
I think that, and having you mention Murray Freed reminds me of the importance of self-advocacy. I think that what's happened is that Rob and I have developed a sort of stage routine that we use whenever we're trying to work with his advocate for his issues. Murray Fried once told Rob that he must advocate with physicians himself.
Yes.
I will say that when Rob broke his hip and Murray Fried said, well, just go to bed for 6 weeks. And Rob said, over my dead body, I'll go to bed. Literally, I'll go to bed. And gave him kind of a hard time. And Murray said, Robert, I don't understand where this came from. And Rob's response was, you taught me, Doc.
Woohoo! Good for you. But it's, you know, it's a back and forth. And, you know, we are not infallible. We forget things. We, you know, it's good that you were able to be honest about what you wanted and what you needed. And it's really important to be able to advocate for yourself. That's great. Yeah,
I think the whole concept of it in-home care would be great, especially for occupational therapy and a whole range of other issues. But physical therapy, just the physical therapy I've gotten in the home is very limited because mm-hmm. of equipment.
Yep.
How do you handle that?
Well, I'm not talking about doing the whole rehab process from home. I think what I'm trying to say is a model where you would see your primary care physician, you know, every year or every couple of years. But if you think you have a UTI, you pick up the phone, you call your nurse practitioner. She does a home visit, collects a urine, and you know, deals with some of the routine stuff. You still do have to. You know, go to a seating clinic or go to a physical therapy department that has equipment, because you're absolutely right. You can't do much in the home. It's really very limited, and you want to get out. It's the difference between being able to exercise on your own and being able to go to the gym, that there's different places. So I do think that you can't do everything in the home. There are going to be times when someone is sick enough to be in a hospital. There are going to be times when you have to go to the office to get seen or to see a specialist. Not everything can be done in the home, but it's a start.
Hi, we have another webcast question.
Okay.
And this is from somebody who is in Shreveport, Louisiana, mm-hmm. and is wondering, he's so far away from this type of service, how can somebody that far away get this kind of service? He's also concerned about if there's a difference between numbers for people of color and how they're treated versus other types of people.
I would look up the model systems and see which one is closest. Probably University of Alabama, I would think, would be the closest. And contact them by phone, try to see if anybody from their center could speak to your internist. If there are specific issues, you know, I'm not sure the distances, but again, there are model systems across the country that do have resources for people who have specialized issues. And I think, unfortunately, not every doctor and every emergency room in the country is going to be able to deal with this, but everybody can pick up the phone and call the model systems and talk to whoever is on call and say, I've got a patient in my emergency room with such and such, and I'm not sure what to do. What do you recommend? As far as the question about how you're treated, you know, again, I think that for the most part, we've come a long way from where we were as a country years and years ago. And there are individuals that are more or less enlightened. And I would say if somebody is treating you poorly, to switch providers and find someone who's going to make you feel more comfortable.
Uh, This is in response to the person who was asking about if they want had an idea for a device and wanted to get it built. There is a local makerspace in Somerville called Artisans Asylum, and they finally got the ramp added to their main entrance just a few days ago. We're still working on disabled person parking, but if you want a community of people who make stuff, that's one place to go, and they do occasionally borrow faculty from MIT and Harvard. Also, out of the University of Massachusetts at Lowell, there's a center called M2D2, which is to help people create medical device startups.
Ooh,
so cool. If you have ideas, those two might be able to help you.
Dr. Bergman, thank you for a wonderful lecture. Thank you all for coming this evening. We are really looking forward to future lecture series together across the two model system centers. Please remember to fill out your surveys and give us any ideas that you have about future talks that you'd like to hear. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thanks very much.